Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala hama ba'd. Today we began our recitation with the beautiful verses at the end of Surah Al-Furqan that describes the believers. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا. The servants of Ar-Rahman are those who walk humbly on this earth. And then the second characteristic, وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. When the ignorant people address them, their speech in return is to say, Salam, peace. And in the same series of verses, a few verses later, Allah Azza wa Jal says of the characteristics, وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا. When they pass by vain talk, idle talk, they pass by indignity, they do not get involved in idle talk. Yesterday we recited the beginning of Surah Al-Mu'minun. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. And the second characteristic, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ. The believers are successful, those who are humble and khushu' in their prayers, and those who turn away from vain talk. So notice, turning away from idle talk, turning away from vain talk, is a key characteristic of the righteous and the believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Qur'an, and our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stresses the importance of guarding the tongue from vain talk, from idle talk. Laghu is a term that means that which is of no use, that which is of no value. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the believers are those who do not engage in laghu. Their tongues do not get involved in that which will bring them harm or even that which is of no use to them. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever guarantees me two things, I guarantee him paradise. They said, what? He said, what is between his cheeks and what is between his legs? Meaning the private organ and the tongue. These two organs are the main cause of destruction amongst people. And that is what they say and the desires that they follow. Whoever guarantees me these two organs that they are within the Sharia, I guarantee him in response that they will go to paradise. And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned about the dangers of the tongue. Mu'adh ibn Jabal said, O Messenger of Allah, will Allah give us a hisab of what we speak? Even our speech will be accounted for on Judgment Day. And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam responded, woe to you, O Mu'adh, and what other reason is there that people will be dragged on their faces into Jahannam except for what their tongues have harvested, for what their tongues have sown, and they will then face the repercussions of their tongues. Brothers and sisters, our scholars have said the tongue is a direct window to the heart. When the tongue is bad, when the tongue is filthy, when the tongue is involved in sin, it is automatically demonstrating that the heart is a heart of sin. And when the tongue is good, and the tongue is pure, and the tongue avoids the laghu, then the heart as well will avoid the laghu. What are some of the main things we should avoid? Some things we should avoid. Number one is that which is of no concern to us. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, of the perfection of one's iman is that you leave that which is not your business. So the first thing we avoid with our tongues is to talk about the gossip and the rumors and the innuendos that unfortunately some segments of society love to thrive on. None of your business, don't get involved, and keep a pure tongue. Number two, and gossip always leads to number two. Number two is to mention something negative about another person when he's not there, i.e. backbiting. To talk about other people. So when you're sitting in a gathering, make sure the topic of conversation never wanders to a person who's an acquaintance or friend whom you know but is not sitting in that gathering unless you praise the person. You may praise somebody behind their back, but you may not mention anything negative that the person would not like to be told in his absence. And by the way, as it is well known, backbiting means you are telling the truth but behind the person's back. You're not lying, because if you're lying, this is the third sin, and that is slander and lying, which is a separate category than backbiting. Backbiting is to mention something that is meant to make fun of, to ridicule, to put somebody down, to embarrass somebody. That is backbiting. You're mentioning a tidbit, a gossip that might be true, but you are saying it so that people can gossip and tattletale behind somebody's back. That is backbiting. If you add to this lying, saying about the person, this leads us to category four, and that is slander and lying. And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I warn you about lying, for lying leads to fujur, to blatant evil. And somebody asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, can a believer be this, can a believer be that? And they mentioned many things. Can a believer be a coward? And the Prophet said, yes, it's possible, maybe the mu'min is a coward. Can the believer utter a lie? Can the believer be a kadhab? And the Prophet said, no, the mu'min is not a kadhab. Perhaps some believers are cowards, perhaps some believers are weak, but the mu'min cannot be a kadhab. So he negated iman from the one who is the habitual liar. And the last point we'll mention, and again, much more can be said, but time is limited. The last point we'll mention that we should purify our tongues from is vulgarities and curse words, vile language, using language that is considered to be filthy or demeaning. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah does not love the fahish and the badhi, the one who uses vulgarities, the one who is badhi, crude terminologies. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said of the signs of a hypocrite is that when he gets angry, he uses vulgar language. It is not befitting that the believer utter obscenities. Unfortunately, it has become common in our younger generation. They think it is cool to be using these words, but the fact of the matter is it is not befitting the dignity of a believer that such vulgarities come from our mouths. Brothers and sisters, I want to link this topic directly to this month. One of the main goals of fasting is to control the tongue. And we learn this explicitly from the hadith that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that when one of you is fasting and then somebody comes and irritates him, curses him, slanders him, gets him angry, do not respond back except by saying, Allahumma inni sa'im, Allahumma inni sa'im. In other words, one of the main goals of this month is to control our tongues. And that's why we're all monitoring our tongues throughout these 30 days. So the point is, when this month finishes, we should then maintain, we should sustain the purity of the tongue. We have to develop a better character about our tongue. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, O Messenger of Allah, what do you fear the most? He held on to his tongue and he said, Hada, this is what I fear the most. If this is our Prophet, how about us? Another man came and said, O Messenger of Allah, what is the way to be saved? Ma sabilun najah? How do I save myself? The Prophet said, Amsik alayka lisanak. Hold your tongue, keep your tongue in check, and be happy with your house. Meaning, don't be greedy for more and more. Be content with what you have and cry over your sins. That is the way you will be saved. So, number one, he said, keep your tongue in check. And then be content with what you have. And then be regretful for your sins. You will be safe. And indeed, brothers and sisters, if you think about it, how much dhulm is done by the tongue. How much ghibah, how much namima, how much gossip, how much problems come when we say things. And our scholars have said that the tongue damages more than an instrument, than even the knife. Because the wound of the knife heals, but the wound that comes from the tongue sometimes never heals. How many relationships have been broken? How many marriages have been destroyed because of the stupidity and the foolishness that the tongue utters and then it regrets. But once it comes out, it can never come back again. Brothers and sisters, the way to be saved when it comes to the dangers of the tongue. Number one, remember, مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. Not a single word comes from his mouth except that there are angels that are ever vigilant and they are ever monitoring. Remember this, be conscious of it. Number two, our scholars have said is that one of the ways you can prevent problems of the tongue is to not speak when you are angry. Our Prophet ﷺ told us, when you're angry, be quiet. Do not speak. Don't speak when you're angry. Wait till you calm down so that you can think before you speak. And then number three, and the final thing we'll mention, of the ways we can control our tongue is to increase the use of the tongue in good. Our scholars have said, the one who constantly does dhikr automatically protects his tongue. The one who's always remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala automatically protects the tongue from falling into evil. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all to say only that which is good and to utilize our tongue in that which is beneficial. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.